Not long ago, the director of a hospital told me that he had to fire nurses in order to free up money to hire more office workers. So when I asked him, why on earth would you do such a thing? You know what he told me? He told me he needed those office workers to be able to justify to the health insurance companies that he was actually spending his hospital budget on necessary care. Now, is there anyone out here who thinks this is a great idea to spend your hospital's budget? Not one single hand. And yet, this is how we do run hospitals. And not alone in this country, but in many, many other countries in the Western world. As an investigative journalist, for years, I've been looking for an answer to the question, why do market forces so often fail to make our public services better? Because it seems strange, doesn't it? Because this is exactly what our political leaders have led us to believe for decades. And with the idea itself, it's understandable. Let me explain this to you by taking the market of bread. We don't need a public service to make sure bread got made, right? Nor do we need a government to set fair prices for bread. No. Everybody can bake a bread. And if your bread tastes better than the next one and it's more affordable than the next guy's, then people will buy your bread. And this way you can make a living. And this is how markets work. And I'm using bread now as an example, but I could have used many other examples as well. Without this free market right now, we wouldn't have airplanes. And a lot of you came in by an airplane, I'm sure. We wouldn't have cars. Without the free market, we wouldn't even have our cell phones. So the point I'm trying to make here is that, and I really mean this, the free market in itself is awesome. However, 15 years ago, I had an experience firsthand with a public service that was not yet challenged by market forces, where it turned out that the market wasn't as awesome as we might expect. Allow me to take you up on a trip down to memory lane. Look at this fella. You recognize him? Yes, this is me. When I was a student, I was working at the Dutch Postal Service to pay for my studies. And back then, it's good for you to know, the Dutch Postal Service still had a monopoly. And it was the most efficient system I have ever seen. You could literally, from every street corner in the country, you could send a letter as late as 6 at night and be certain that it would be delivered at the right address and the next morning anywhere in the country. But then the government came along and they thought, well, if post is already as awesome as a monopoly, just imagine how awesome it will be if you put it in the free market. So they opened up the market, and a long story short, at some point, we had 4 different distribution networks who all had to serve only a piece of the market. Now, I don't think I need to explain that this isn't very efficient, but just to make my point, this is what happened to the price of a stamp in the Netherlands. Ever since we privatized the market, the price doubled. And I see some of you thinking, I don't care. I never send a letter, I just use email. Right? Well, fair enough. But the same thing happened to healthcare, and it's a lot harder to avoid ever going to a doctor, is it? So what happened to healthcare? Healthcare, unlike the postal service, has always been expensive for the government. And the reason it's expensive for the government is medical treatments are often so expensive that the patient can't pay for them themselves. So, since we consider access to healthcare as a human right, the government was paying for it. So the government had an idea. If it's so expensive and we have this awesome market mechanism, why don't we privatize healthcare? Why don't we put market forces in place? Because quality would go up and prices would go down, right? Right? Wrong. It didn't. And to explain to you why this happened, as soon as you privatize your healthcare system, it doesn't make your citizens, after you privatize it, your citizens all of a sudden can't pay for their healthcare themselves. And if the government isn't paying for it anymore, then who is? Well, enter the insurance companies. But what is the greatest fear of an insurance company? Is it you dying? No, eh? It's not. Now, the greatest fear of the insurance company is having to spend more than they collect. So what do insurance companies do? Insurance companies want to make sure that every euro or every dollar they spend is spent well on healthcare. And therefore, they make doctors register every single thing they do with a patient. Remember the hospital director I told you about? Well, this is why. And just let me show you what this looks like in a chart. In the lower wedge, we see the amount of doctors when they privatize the healthcare system in the United States. And in the upper wedge, we see the number of administrative staff. Do you know what this chart tells me? It tells me that market forces were not very successful to make healthcare more efficient. It did the opposite. And I'm talking about healthcare right now, but it could have used many more examples in public services, from education to energy companies to water supplies, just to name a few. So the real question we need to ask ourselves is not, are market forces awesome? Is the free market awesome? Because sometimes it is. But we have to face it. Sometimes it's just a bad idea. So what we need to find out here is, when is it a good idea? And when is it a bad idea? And to be honest, it took me 8 years of investigative journalism to come up with an answer. And when I did, it took me a 200-page book to explain this to you. And now I only have a little over 4 minutes left. So this is kind of a problem. So please allow me to explain this to you as one-dimensional as I possibly can. We are all here with a nice crowd. Who of you had to build a highway this morning to be able to get here? Oh, no one. Sorry. You're TED people. You love the environment. Who of you had to build a railroad to get here? No one. Okay, different example. We're in the Netherlands. This is a country below sea level. Who of you has invested in dikes? No one, really. Do we need to remember you what happens if we don't have dikes in place? And that we come to the reason we founded governments in the first place. We need a government to bundle our collective needs in ways the market never will. And I'm talking about dikes, but trust me, for human beings, there are many ways of drowning. We have poverty, we have crime, we have sickness. By the way, did I mention that I'm not a communist? I really love the market, but what I want to underline is that markets can only function if the governments do their jobs, and therefore, I want to show you what it should look like. This is Westkapelle. This is a village in the southwest of the Netherlands, and here you have it. On the one hand, we have this strong dike built by the government that keeps all the people safe. And on the other hand, we have this village. And in this village, we have butchers and bakers and farmers and all the other awesome things that the market can do. But it can only function as long as there's a strong government to protect it and to make sure the people are safe in there. The problem is, we still have a lot of politicians and a lot of politician leaders in our Western world right now that tell us, yeah, we don't really need the government. Market forces are more effective. Well, let me tell you this plain and simple. They are wrong. Let me give you an example. This week in the Netherlands, we had a strike of school teachers. And those teachers were striking because, and their cause was very, very wide supported by parents in this country. Because everybody feels teachers are underpaid, and everybody feels teachers are facing too much bureaucratic hassle. Yet something else happened this week. We got a new government. And you know what the ticket is? They are going to lower the taxes. And this can't go on like this. And it's not only in this country. It's happening in a lot of countries around the world. Look at France. Look at the UK. Look at the United States. All the leaders still say we should make the government smaller and we should lower taxes. But what we need, what we really need, is we need to make our governments great again. And greatness comes at a price. I don't like to pay taxes either, but let's face it. If we don't do it, then who's going to protect us when we really need it? So therefore, I need you, and 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 I need myself to keep this in mind. Because as long as we support politics that promotes smaller governments and lower taxes, no new dikes will be created. And let's face it, it doesn't matter if you're rich or poor, but sometimes in life you will have to face a moment when you need a dike, and then you better have it in place. Please take this into consideration the next time you have to cast your vote. Thank you.